Okay, morning everyone. Again, this is Jim Keeney, Central Region Headquarters. Welcome to the Standardized Storm Summaries training. We have a subset of the team available with us this morning going through the training. We'll let Kelly Whitaker introduce those folks when we get going. I want to start off by thanking everybody for joining us this morning. I'll do a little housekeeping statements here at the start, and then we'll go ahead and get started with the training per se. Everyone is muted at this time. So if you do have a question, there's a couple ways you can ask that question. First off, if you entered your audio PIN when you started the presentation, you can raise your hand in the raise hand function there on the right-hand side of your screen, and then I'll unmute you and you can ask the question directly. If you did not type in your PIN number, I'll be able to notice that, and you will have to type in your question, and I can read it and we'll answer it that way. So with that, also I am recording this session, so this will be made available to all offices for those that were unable to attend, and then for playback later as a refresher. So with that, Kelly Whitaker, if you'd like to take it, it's all yours.
Okay, thank you, Jim. Good morning, everyone. I am Kelly Whitaker. I'm the ITO at the Rapid City office, and I'm glad you're joining us this morning. I'm going to be talking about the new Central Region Standardized Storm Summaries creator that our team has put together. In this training, I will introduce you to our team. I will talk about the purpose and need of this project that we did. I will show you a site example. I will talk about the mandatory implementation. Then we'll look at how to create an event summaries web page. And then Andrea, or I'm sorry, Kevin is going to talk about how to create the storm summary page on each of your websites. And then Andrea is going to go over the interactive damage mapper. Now, after each of these sections, we will allow for questions. So, and you can also either raise your hand or type in a question in the chat while we are presenting, and then we will get to those questions after each section. This is our team. As you can see, we have a nice mix of different positions that were included on the team. Leads and interns and WCMs and ITOs were well represented. On July 31st last year, Jim Keeney put out an email request for volunteers for this team. In it, he stated the purpose of the team, and that is partners in the public place a significant demand for infrared weathers, have responded by developing post-event web pages that contain differing summaries that include track maps and reports, but there's no standard being applied. Since there are a variety of ways this is being done, we would like to take an inventory of what is out there currently and combine to create one top-notch page for all to use. In September of 2015, our team was formed and chartered with developing a way for all of our offices in Central Region to have a common presence for past storms and events. This is a cross-section of Central Region's storm summary pages that existed when our team was created. We went through and inventoried all the different offices and what they are using and what they came up with in order to create a plan of what we could use as a standard in region. These are screenshots from various offices, and you can clearly see even though the offices were fulfilling the needs of the public, there's a standard that was definitely needed. During our search, we found some great graphics, maps, statistical displays, and areas for pictures that we knew needed to be incorporated into the standard. One thing we noticed immediately was that each of these, most of them, had direct links at the top that would take users directly to the part of the storm that they wanted to see. So we knew that this was definitely number one on our list that we would have to include. Now this is the new storm summary pages that some of our offices are already telling us it's a wonderful tool to use already. The standard summaries now have a cohesive look to them. The users will be able to have the same familiar experience no matter which office in Central Region that they visit online. And you'll see that we incorporated those same links into the page, and you'll also see these are all different offices, Wichita, Indianapolis, La Crosse, and Louisville, but yet they have different tabs. So that is going to be completely customizable by the offices as far as what is included. Now Kevin is going to show you how to create this page shortly. So the way you get to the new event summaries is on the main web pages. You will go to the climate and past weather menu item and go all the way to the bottom, the event summaries link. That will bring up this page, the event summaries page. Every office will have the same tabs, and under each one will be where the links are to those storm summary pages. I'm going to take you to this actual page, and I'm going to show you what these storm summary pages look like. So let's click on that. Well, first of all, I wanted to show you under the tabs. Each tab has a paragraph underneath it that explains what is included in that tab. So if you're unsure what goes where, or where to put something unusual, you can hopefully figure that out through these paragraphs. So now let's go to this March 15th storm. Now I will show you in just a minute how to create this page right here. So we'll go here. And Kevin is going to demonstrate this page to you. And then Andrea, later on, is going to show you how to create this interactive map.
Mic check, 1, 2.
Hello? We can hear you. All right, now, this page is very simple for users to navigate to get to whatever part of the storm they would like to go to. The first tab here shows the tornadoes and the events, along with the interactive map. And then these tabs, like I said before, these are all customizable. You can include as many or as few tabs as you wish. And Kevin will discuss the need for each of these in his section. I just want to iterate that this page is very simple for our users to use, but it's also very simple to create. And we will continue to make it even more simple as we get suggestions from all of you. All right, so. The initial announcement of the project was made on February 22nd, 2016. Todd Shea sent out that email for everybody to get familiar with the project that we were working on, and he sent out all the information, the different links, so that you could check it out. You will have this month to get your event summary page in place and to try out the new standards. You can still keep your old storm summaries and link them to this new page, so there's no need to go back through old storms and create the new storm summary page for those storms. We just ask that after June 1st, that your event summary page is in place, and after June 1st, that you start using the Storm Page Creator that we will be showing you. Headquarters will be sending out an email mid-May with the official announcement for this. Now I want to show you the help page that Central Region has on their Google site. It has at the very top are all the instructions. The Storm Summary Creator is what Kevin will be going over with you. This is a link to the actual creator. Of course, this is a link to the instructions. And the same thing for the Interactive Damage Mapper, that map that I showed you. This is the link to the actual tool, and this is the instructions and a quick reference guide. Andrea will be covering that. And then I will be covering this actual template and instructions. So this is the page that you can go to that has all the great information. At the bottom of the page are all the people who are on the team. So if you have any questions, you can email any one of us and we will get the answer to you. All right, now I'm going to show you how to create that event summary page. So I'm going to click on the instructions here. First, I'll show you this template. All that is some code. And then this is the instructions. So the way you're going to do this is you're going to bring up CMS, which I have. You're going to log into CMS, and you're going to create a brand new web page. So you choose web page, and then that you put in the top area is in the instructions, so you can just cut and paste all of this information in. And the next thing you're going to do is you're going to click on this source button just once, and it'll gray out all the buttons. This means that we can put in our HTML code. So you go back to this page, highlight the entire page by doing a Control A. And copy, Control C. I'm going to copy it in here, do a Control V, and then save. And that's it. Now you have your page that will show up on your site. I'll go here under Event Summaries, and it hasn't updated yet. It might take a little while for that to show up. I'll show you that in a minute. But as we can see, working just fine. The one thing that I want to point out to you, and if you have questions about this, we can answer your questions. Some offices already have yearly summaries in PDF form. And so we provided this section for those offices so that their users can go back to the month and the year and get those summaries. Now, if your office does not have this, in the instructions, we have a section here that explains how to get rid of that section. So all you need to do is you will go into CMS, you'll go back to source, you'll go down and find all those at symbols here somewhere. Okay, this part of the code does not have the at symbols, but this here that says end of storm status scripting, you'll grab that and go up to the start and just delete that section. And then save, and then you'll see down below here that that section was removed. So that'll be your choice if you include that section or not. Now, what you will do this month and before the June 1st deadline is all you'll need to do is to go in here and add a link to the summary that you already have created for all of your past events. Right here. All you have to do is highlight this, type in your description, and create a link to that page that you already have. So I am going to open this up to questions. That's all I have for this section. And when I'm done, Kevin is going to teach you how to create the storm summary page itself. Jim, does anybody have questions?
I do see one here. Jim Cramper I unmuted you. You want to go ahead and ask your question? Jim, are you there? Well, let me go ahead. He typed it in here. I'll read it. His question is, what about other National Weather Service regions? Will Weather Service headquarters come down someday and say this is how it will be done? At this time, we haven't really coordinated with the other regions. At this time, I did pass this on to the headquarters, so they are aware of what we're doing. But other than the other regions, it's kind of, they're doing their own thing as well. So if headquarters decides they want to do it, I would hope that our prototype here would be a starting point for the other regions, is the hope. Yeah, okay, I don't see any other questions, Kelly, so we may go on to Kevin. Okay, Kelly, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here. Are you going to switch it over to Kevin's monitor?
Do that right now.
Thank you.
Okay, Kevin, you should have it.
All righty. Thanks, Jim and Kelly. I'm Kevin Scow with the National Weather Service office in Des Moines. And what I'll be covering in this section is how to create your individual storm event web pages. So I'll start off here. Again, Kelly hit on this Central Region Google Sites page that we've created, and this was sent out in an email Jim sent out to everybody. So it would be a good idea for all your offices to bookmark it or have a quick link to this page, because there's a big wealth of information on this page. In addition to the quick links we have at the top, we have a number of helpful resources for you guys to aid in creating your pages quickly. Some example pages with different styles set up. Because this page, first and foremost, is designed to be as customizable for you guys as possible, while at the same time maintaining a standardized layout. And so we really strive to achieve that. And these are some of the examples of the pages we've come out with so far. For my section, I'm going to be following the instructions relatively closely, so if you have the opportunity, it would be great if you could pull up the instructions here on the Storm Summary Creator, because I'll be following them relatively closely throughout my section. So once you have an event and you want to create a storm summary for that, you would go and click on our Storm Summary Creator link here, and it will bring you to this page. There are some basic instructions at the top, some more detailed instructions linking to that same link I showed you just a few seconds ago at the top, but the main meat of what you're going to be doing is down here towards the middle to bottom of the page. This is where you will select the tabs you want, how many sections you want in each tab, and a whole plethora of other different options. So the tabs can be broken down into two main groups. The first half of the tabs are essentially what kind of event you had, the tornado, wind or hail, flooding, etc. The bottom half of the tabs down here are more like your supporting documents, the photos from the event, the radar imagery, storm reports, etc. So you can choose how many tabs you want on the size and the scope of your event. So an example here, I can choose, as many tabs. I can choose all the tabs if I want them. Obviously, you probably don't want to choose snow and ice and tornado at the same time, hopefully. But you can choose, for this example, we'll choose tornado, wind and hail, flooding. The extra tab, it's kind of a catch-all tab for any events that don't really fit the main options we have up here. So an example could be a heat wave. One of my favorite phenomena is a heat burst. So we can put heat burst in there, and it'll name that tab appropriately. So you have the control to name your own tab if you have a certain special event that happens in your area. We can do photos and video, radar imagery, storm reports, rainfall. And the additional info tab is another kind of catch-all tab for other different information that people might want. And you can see next to the tornado tab, there are these teaser images. And that allows you, especially for, say, smaller, lower impact tornado events, it allows you to kind of merge that photos and videos and radar tab into the tornado tab itself. It puts image placeholders underneath the track information and maps, so we're not spreading the information out too thinly for very small events. However, for larger events, it is recommended that you try to space the information out into the photos and videos and radar tab and other tabs as well. Otherwise, the page could get really long and encompass a lot of scrolling for the user, and we are trying to eliminate or minimize that as much as possible. So after you've chosen your tabs, we'll choose teaser images there, you can choose how many subsections you want. And each tornado should have its own subsection. That'll create the table, the track map, placeholders, and other fields necessary to put the information in for each tornado. So an example, you'll have to put a minimum of one, the value of one, into this field. Otherwise, the field will come up blank, and we'll hopefully look at addressing it so it auto-populates with at least one in future builds. But for this example, we can put two. You can put as many as you want. You can do two for the photos and video and two for the radar as well. And these will create tables and image placeholders separated with headers so you can segment your event, you know, for different tornadoes, for different types of events in your photos and videos and radar section. And we'll show some examples of that here once the code is created. So also you have the option of choosing which tab opens first in the creator. By default, the tabs will open up in the first one checked will be the tab that opens up. By default, it's going to be tornado if you have a tornado. So if I didn't have a tornado event here, it would be wind and hail and flooding and so forth. But this option would be useful, say, if you have a big derecho event and the primary impact was wind and you had one little small tornado. You could choose the wind and hail tab to open up first and therefore bring the user to the primary impact of the event. And then the tabs will not be reoriented. This tab will just be the one that opens up first in the list. So once you've chosen all the information you want here, and again, it can be as simple or as complex as you wish. It's really under your control. You can type a short summary of what happened here. You can also type this summary placeholder for this overview section will be imported into the CMS, so you can type it up later on as if you wish. And then finally, as you head towards the bottom, you have the options to insert images at certain locations in the overview section, whether you want an image to the right-hand side of the summary or you want a table with a couple of images below the summary as well, and we'll choose both just to show them here. So once you have all your options selected, you will hit the Submit button, and this will be the page that comes up. And you'll notice right away it doesn't look quite right. None of the formatting is there, none of the options show up, and that's okay. That's exactly what the page should look like. What we want to do is then take the base code that was generated here and then copy it into the CMS. So to do that, you would simply hit Control-U on your browser, and that will bring up the source code. You want to hit Control-A to select everything, Control-C to copy, and then you'll go into your CMS. If you haven't done so already, once you've logged in, you would go to Content, Add Content. You would then the list that shows up here at the top, and then fill in the information as needed here. Something you want to give your page a unique name. I try to give it at least the year, month, and day, and then storm summary or tornado event or something unique. The HTML title tag is up to you. Highly recommend at least having at least the date in there, and then, you know, summary of the severe weather event or tornado outbreak or something. The meta tags here at the bottom are up to you how to fill them in. Try to describe your event as best as possible. So once you have all this information filled in, you go down. You would click that source button that Kelly said earlier. So you can see this is how it would normally come up. You see all these options are still black and selectable. By selecting the source button, they will gray out. So now you're in source code mode. And simply hit Control-V to paste all the code in there. And then you can come back out of source mode. And there you are. Your template is all available for you. You didn't have to edit any source code. So with the baseline template there for you to use. So once that is all done, you know, you can recommend saving it to make sure nothing gets lost. But you can see what the CMS will do. We'll save it up here just so you can see it. The CMS, just like as Kelly showed in the event page itself, is all the content will be listed in one long column in the CMS editor, and your tabs will be listed as bullets towards the top of the page. And that's normal. That's the way the CMS is rendering the code. However, once you get towards the bottom here, we'll show this preview page, you'll see that your tabs in the preview have been formatted in the correct manner. Your tornado, we selected tornado to be first, so that's the top tab, and all the tabs are available here in the final output. So we'll start from the top here. You can type your overview section right here. I generally try to limit it to about a paragraph, maybe no more than 4 or 5 sentences. You can then choose, you'll see these placeholders here for the images that you would like to put into the final summary. And previously, you would, if you're the PIO for your storm survey event or you're putting together the survey, you would have previously uploaded these images to the CMS via the media management option that's under site configuration here, and then go to media management. And this will be the page that would come up. We recommend maybe creating a folder under this images directory here, maybe called events, or in this case, we have an older one called significant events that we're using. And then you can create a subfolder underneath that for each of your events. That way you keep your images organized. So in this case, I just created a test subdirectory with some test images in there for this event. So to load an image up, you would simply right-click the image here in the CMS, go down to Image Properties, wait for that to load up here, and then under URL, you would go to Browse Server and then attach your image there. Something that is different that Kelly showed with these pages, I'll show an example here of the final format, is we incorporated code that allows the images to expand and contract on their own without having to the user having to go to a separate page. So if you click the image, you'll see it expands and the user can view it without going to a new page, and they can simply click and close it as they see fit. And that was something we wanted to see in these pages that other offices were using that we wanted to incorporate. Now, to get that to work, there's a little bit of a different change here. It's actually more of a simple change for you if you're adding images to your page, to your server once, to load that image in. So if I go to Browse Server here, let the Media Manager load here in a second, you'll then select your image, and that'll be all you have to do. You don't have to go back to that link tab that we saw earlier and load up a second link to that image. You only have to do this once. So we simplified the process there. So for an example, let's load that track map I was showing earlier. You can just double click it, and it loaded in there as well. So you do not have to do anything with this link tab at all. You just have to do this once, and that's all you have to do. So then once you're done, we'll click OK, and there the map is as well. So then you can type your caption down here to describe what you're seeing. You can also add more images down here, and we wanted to make this as customizable as possible. So let's say you only have 2 images down here that you only want to show. You can simply go to the cell, to this example here, and delete the cells and delete everything off you don't need. So now I only have two images to use. So you're not forced into using a hard-coded template. This is very customizable. You can change it to fit your needs as much as possible. You'll notice here that some of the images are pre-formatted in their dimensions, and we generally formatted them into landscape format. Some of them you'll see are wider than others. The images can be changed, their dimensions can be changed. So if I go back to that image I was showing earlier, that track map that I loaded up into that preview, that right-hand image pane, we'll load that back up into this particular image placeholder, and then we'll load it up. You'll see it may be hard to see, but the image is squished. And so if you want to make this image, say, a widescreen format, or in some cases even a portrait format, you would simply right-click the image, go back to that image properties box, and then we'll go back down to this middle section here. You see this refresh button, and you'll hit refresh, and it'll reformat the image to its original dimensions. Hit the padlock button here right next to it, and then change the dimensions back down to the size you want. So in this case, our original height in that row was 150 pixels, so I hit 150 to bring it back down to that size. And now you see we have that widescreen image available for you. And that's really crucial to do if you have images that aren't in the standard format, because the code, the enlarging code that we have here on this page, will take the dimensions that you have set that you're seeing right now to blow up the image. So if it looks squished down here, it's going to look squished when you make it bigger. And so it might resize the image if need be. But for the vast majority of cameras, with the exception of maybe cell phone cameras, you're going to have pictures in landscape format. So we chose the easiest and most common dimensions and aspect ratios for you to use, and then you can adjust them on the fly if need be. So again, once you've done it once or twice, it'll be like second nature to you for changing this and getting the images into the way you want. So next we'll go down into the tornado section, and this is an example of the layout you'll see for one tornado subsection. So what we did here, you'll see there's two subsections here because I chose two from our list. You'll see on the left-hand side a table format, much like you would have seen in a public information statement or on a lot of other web pages. There's really nothing changed here as far as the information. At the top left-hand side of the page, you would type, say, the location of the tornado, reference to a city that was hit, or the distance, the starting point location of the tornado. You would then type the county name, the counties that were impacted. So you would just, type the counties you wanted in there. You would type the date, the time, and if you wanted to fill out this field here, you wanted to put your own time zone here. Since Central Region spans three different time zones, I couldn't just put standard daylight time or central time. You can put Eastern time, standard time, however you want. Just type the EF rating there. Estimated peak winds, path length, width, and so forth. You would then put in a short summary of the tornado and try to limit it to maybe three or four sentences. Otherwise, it's just going to keep running on and on, and you're going to have a lot of white space below your map down here, sentences, three sentences or so. The track map option here is is designed that to export it from the DAT. So to export an image from the DAT, a track from the DAT, I'm choosing this event here back from one of our favorite events, June 30th, 2014. And you can see it's a pretty messy map. Something that I really try to push is to assign unique events to each tornado, and that way you can weed out all this other information surrounding a track to get a clean snapshot of the image. So in this case, I gave the you can type the event ID right here and towards the upper right-hand side of the page. I tend to give it a year, month, day, and then the overall tornado in that event for us, and click the filter button, and suddenly you have that nice clean track that you're able to show. You can zoom in, line it up as you wish. You can turn the points on and off. So if I only want to show polygons, I can choose this so that only the polygons are visible. And then to create a screen capture of that track, you can do it in a couple of ways. The one I would recommend is simply go into the Print Image toolbox here on the top of the screen. You would click that, hit Export JPEG, and wait for that to load. And then you would then simply name it down here. Make sure to have the .jpg extension on there. You can see I've already saved one off from this track already. And so you would name your track that way, and it will create a screen capture of what you're currently viewing in the DAT, and you can go from there and upload it into the CMS. So in this case, we've already created our track. We'll go here and go to Image Properties, go back to the Media Manager, and we'll load that image in there. You will notice on that page that the image dimensions I had there earlier, you notice it was in a widescreen format. And that's because I'm aware I have gone to those Windows widescreen monitors. And so you can see in the example here, there's a much wider aspect ratio than what most other images would have. And so we tailored the size of that image to match what most of you are going to be exporting from your monitors. So in this case, here's the track. We'll double click it and wait for it to load here, and then hit OK, and you'll see it's already there. It's pre-formatted, ready to go. It has the correct dimensions, and we're ready to go down to whatever we want to next. The downloadable KMZ file is an option for you. You certainly don't have to have it there. It is something the CMS only supports KMZ file uploading through the rsync process, so probably more something that you, that someone who's more the ITO or someone who's more tech savvy in the CMS would be interested in doing. The instructions for how to do that are all covered in that instructions page I was alluding to earlier. But if you don't need this, you can simply hit delete and get rid of it and go from there. You can see here at the bottom we have those teaser images. If we had not selected that teaser box, this would not exist. The tornado subsection would end right there at the very bottom, right below where the KMZ file link would have been, the placeholder would have been. But the uploading of images to this is the same as I've shown several times now. You would just right-click, go to Image Properties, go to your Media Management, and go from there. So I'll show an example here of an image that may be in portrait mode just to show how to customize that. So you would go back to your browse server, and then once this loads, we'll choose an image that was taken from a cell phone camera of, in this case, we'll just have some hail to show this as the example. So here's an image that's obviously in portrait mode. We'll double-click it, and we'll put it in there. And you'll see right away it looks squished because it's not in the right aspect ratio or dimension. So we'll go back to Image Properties, and we'll see the overall height of the image was 120 pixels. So if I hit Refresh, we'll see it goes back to its original size. We'll then check that padlock, and we'll change the height back down to 120 or so. And there the image is now in its correct dimensions and ready to view in the image viewer. There is a lot of other customizable options here. We'll just scroll down here. You have the enhanced Fujita scale at the bottom. The tabs were listed here at the top. You can see each tab and the order it's in. It's not recommended to edit these, but they are certainly, you can edit these as you see fit. They're all, it's just text you can edit. So an example of when you might want to edit the tabs is say you just have a big wind event and there was really no hail with it. You can go in here and delete the hail shows wind. So again, very customizable for you. You can tailor this to fit your needs as much as possible. Here's the wind and hail section. You would have to rename the title here as if you just wanted wind, you could do that. The subsections, each of these subsections will go to the radar and the photos and video section. So we chose two subsections in the formatter creator, and you can see there's two subsections here with the name header where you would type, for example, which tornado you're talking about, the wind and hail if you wanted to put them in there, if you didn't put it in the wind and hail section. If you have more photos than the baseline four images we have here shown in this table, you can easily just select the table. So you just start, you click your mouse right outside the table here, and this example is Chrome, and you just drag across so everything's highlighted. You'll hit Control C, hit Enter, Control V, and now you have to enter your photos in. And you can delete these columns as you wish to add. If you only have three photos, you can simply go to delete the column, and now you have three photo placeholders to use to put your photos in there. Same with the radar section. And storm reports, you can simply copy and paste the PNS in there, and the formatting should remain okay. Same with rainfall reports. And then under the additional info section, we have some placeholders for, say, if you want to use the SPC categorical outlooks. If you want to do warning lead time, you can use this. Otherwise, simply delete it if you don't want it. And finally, a place at the bottom to put links to other office surveys. As I alluded to, these tables can be copied and pasted after you've created the code so that you can add more sections as you see fit. The tornado tables are easily copyable as well. To do that, you would just start outside the table again where I've clicked. Slowly drag across it so everything is selected. Again, hit Control C, go to the bottom here, right above the Enhanced Fujita section here, and hit Control V, and now you have a new tornado section. So if you start creating the page at the beginning of your survey, and your survey team finds an extra tornado and you have to add a new tornado subsection in there, you can easily copy and paste the table down there and then move on and enter your information as quickly as possible. So we designed this page to be as little source code interaction as possible. So you can do all this via the CMS GUI. It's all familiar, it's all visual, so you don't need to go and do any code editing if you don't need to. There are certainly some options we talk about in the instructions about how to edit the source code if need be for those who wish. 90% of the time you're not the source code and doing edits there. So with that, I think that covers most of my section. Again, Andrea will delve into the interactive map, again, to replace primarily if you don't want to do messing with rsync and uploading KMZ files from the DAT. She'll cover that portion of it as well. So with that, I believe I will go to, oh, one more thing. There was one more thing I wanted to talk about now that I remember. You'll notice between each section that there is a horizontal line between the bottom of a section and the title of another tab. So here an example here. You can see these lines. These lines were put there because there's source code underneath it between the line and the next title that tells the web browser when to break the content up into tabs. So we put that line there to alert you not to do any editing between that line and the next title. If you do so, the tabs will break and it will become a big mess really quickly. So it's a word of caution there if you do happen to delete it. However, if you're in the GUI and you happen to delete something, if I go in here and I delete something and I'm like, oh crap, I can just hit Control Z and bring it right back, just like you would do in Word or PowerPoint or everything else. So if you just happen to delete it by accident, you can hit Control Z and bring it all back as you need to. So that is all I had to cover, and now I will open it up to questions.
Okay, thanks, Kevin. I do have a couple. First one is from Matt Bunkers. His question is, do the number of subsections all have to be the same number?
Absolutely not. You can assign them as much as you want. As I said, each tornado should have its own subsection, but especially, like, say, if you're using the teaser images, you can you don't need to even have a photos and video and radar section if you don't want. If you didn't want to have a wind and hail section and you wanted to show the photos and video for wind and hail in there, you could do four subsections and name two for the tornadoes and two for the wind and hail. You can customize it as much as you want.
Okay, good. The next comment is from Matt Feinlein. I'm probably say that wrong. Matt, you want to go ahead and I've unmuted you. You want to go ahead and ask your question? Matt, you there? Okay, I muted him back. He's got some problem there. Let me go ahead and read what he has there. And he says here, great work by the team. On the events page, this standardized format has a link to storm data. He was wondering if a few other universal links could be added for partners looking larger than one CWA, and it helps direct people to some of our national centers' effective databases. He said he was thinking the NCDC storm events database, maybe the SPC storms report maps, the WPC storm summaries, and the MRCC tornado track tools. These links have worked well for some of our partners, NWS Chicago, for example, in the past. And he says, just a suggestion, maybe more than a question. So what do you guys think about that?
I would be certainly okay with a standardized, with adding those national links to it. That would be up to, I believe Kelly would have more input into that as to, but I don't see a problem with it on my end.
Yeah, I think that's something we could look into. I forgot to mention, too, that we have a feedback link on the Google site at Region. So we will, anything that's put in here and any suggestions made on this call, we will definitely consider.
Yes, this is certainly something we don't want to remain as static. We're not just pushing this out there and leaving it and abandoning it for all you guys to use. We want to support this. We want this to be growing document and something that we can mature and grow as others use it and provide feedback. So we definitely value your feedback when it comes to enhancing these pages.
Okay, thanks Kevin and Kelly. That's all I have so far. So with that, we can go to Andrea's section, and let me go ahead and change presenter.
All right, can everybody hear me okay?
Yep, sound good, and we've got your screen up.
All right. Well, I'm here at Louisville Forecast Center, and I'm going to talk to you today about adding an interactive damage map to these storm summary web pages that you just saw Kevin create. Now, this is not part of the mandatory requirements. You don't have to have one of these maps, but we certainly encourage everyone to try to put one of these on their storm summary web pages. My co-creator in making this program is Mike Callahan, and a lot of the graphics that you'll see on here from Joe Sullivan. Also, Darren and Chris helped with the initial graphics and coding. I want to thank Parks Camp and the DAT team for their support, and also the CR Damage Survey web team. So with that, we'll jump right on in here, trying to explain what exactly is an interactive damage map. I think you already saw a little bit from Kelly there. But we'll go ahead and explore one of these on the web here. So this is basically from one of the events. This is the interactive map, which basically puts data from the DAT, from your storm surveys, on an ESRI-based web map. And this is in zoomed out view. We have several tornadoes for this event. For each tornado in zoomed out view, you can click on the icon and see stats for that specific tornado. And then you can go to different tornadoes and just get those quick stats in zoomed out view. Now you can also zoom into specific tornadoes. You can do that by using your regular roller ball on the mouse, or we have a sort of a zoom to, a quick zoom to feature down in the bottom middle here, where you can pick a tornado and zoom directly to that tornado. And you'll notice as we get into zoomed in view, there's a lot more data there. There's all these little data points, and you can see more detail to the damage track map. This damage track map is actually for an EF1, and it's showing EF0 damage in the blue and then EF1 damage in the green. And so this interactive mapper does support layered polygons, which are drawn in the DAT, as well as it takes the DAT icons, which look different than this. Those are the like neon triangles that you'll see in the DAT. The script that we've created sort of transfers those icons and makes them a little bit more meaningful. We'll zoom in here to some tree damage. For instance, this one here, we zoom in, that was for hardwood trees, and you click on a point, and it basically gives you that information for that point. Try to find one with a picture here. This one has a picture with it. If there's a picture available, then that will show up with the stats. And when you click on the picture, you can get the bigger version for a download or copy to your computer. But this is all data coming from the DAT. It's just reprocessed with to see a key for all those icons. There's a button right below the zooming feature. You can click on that button and see how the icons are constructed. And basically it's just combining the EF scale with the damage indicator symbol and making the icon for each point. Now we've also added additional icons which aren't directly supported in the DAT, but we've done some, a little bit of a magic trick there to get some of the points supported, like for hail damage. If you have really intense, like softball sized hail that makes a bunch of damage, there are special instructions to put a point in the DAT and do something special to make a hail icon pop up. We also have a straight line wind damage that is something that is in the DAT. We also have a flooding, significant flooding icon, and an aerial survey flight icon as well. So I'll go ahead and close that up. Back to the map here, you can, on the bottom left, you can toggle on the points and the paths. In the bottom right, you have an option to download a zipped file for each tornado or one big one for all tornadoes. And so if we were going to download this one, you see it downloaded there in the bottom left, and you'll notice you get a points KMZ and a path KMZ for each tornado or area of damage. And we'll go into how the interactive damage mapper plots that as well, but it is a slicker process than using some manual rsync commands. The actual script does that work for you, and so this might be an easier method of putting downloadable KMLs up on your web page versus having this link right here. So again, we'll cover that a little bit later. But just some of the other map features, you've got a full gallery of base maps from Esri that you can choose. You can put on satellite data if you'd like. You've got a regional view here that you can move your box around to zoom to different areas. Your regular lat-lon readout down in the bottom left, which is not real viewable in this background, there we go, as well as a scale that adjusts to your zoom, and then your typical zoom buttons in the upper left, and the home button to take you back to the regular zoomed out view. That's what we mean by an interactive map, and so now we want to go into how do we get one of these on your storm summary webpage. First, let me take you back to the Sierra Google sites that Kevin and Kelly have hit on. There's some important links here. First of all, the interactive damage mapper will open up this page for you, and this is where you create. We also have a set of Google instructions with this link here that if you want to open those up now, those might be helpful to look at while we're going through the rest of this. But they have a lot of good screen captures and step-by-step instructions on how to create one of these maps and get them into your Storm Summary web page. And then we have a quick reference guide. And this guide is an external and an internal link. So you can use it internally to your other coworkers to show them the features of these interactive maps. And you can also post them on the web, you know, maybe with your first storm survey map that has the interactive map on it, just so that your users see all the different features and how to maximize the use of the interactive map. Okay, so when you go to the interactive damage mapper and you look at that Google set of instructions, the interactive damage mapper does have some shorthand instructions at the very top here. And one of the first things that it says is to export your data from the DAT web editor. And so let's go to that. Okay, so now we're in the DAT web editor. And basically what you're going to do here is you're going to take all of your storm survey data and you're going to export one points file and one path file for each of your damaged areas. The interactive damage mapper can plot tornado damage, straight line wind damage, and intense hail damage. If that's a rarity, but sometimes it does happen. So I just want to go through the process real quick of extracting those. Before we start extraction, a couple data keeping, housekeeping rules here. One of the things about the interactive damage mapper is that it supports damage polygons drawn in the data. It does not damage lines yet. And one reason why we did that was because the damage polygons allow you to vary the width of your damage track. The damage lines or paths do not allow you to do that. You have to set one specific width. And since we are zooming in to fine detail and our users can zoom into fine detail with these interactive maps, we want the damage track to be as representative as possible. And so we want to be able to vary the damage width and draw those tracks as best we can. And so the damage polygons were chosen for to be supported for the plotting. Now in future versions of this software, we will support the damage lines because they do create some useful statistics for us to use. Another thing about the point data, just general mapping practice here, it's good to have at least at a minimum for your map a start point and an end point, and then your points for the highest EF damage or the highest damage that you have in the map there. So you'll want to do that, make sure that you have those points at a minimum for your map. Like I said, for general good mapping practices, and to make your zooming on your map that will be more accurate the more points that you have. There is no limit that we know of to the points that you can have on your damage map, but at a minimum you want to have those areas. Okay, so in extracting these points, you'll hit the extract toolbox in the middle toolbar here. And first you want to hit the cogwheels to turn on wind speed. And you can go back to the main extraction. And like I said, we're going to extract a points file and a polygon file for each area of damage. So we'll go ahead and extract the points first. So we hit the draw polygon button, and we're just going to start drawing around the points that we want to extract. Double click when you're done. And you'll see Esri job submitted in this box while it's extracting the data for you. Give it a second here. All right, and when it's done, it comes up with a KML link, and you'll click on that. And it varies on where the download shows up in every browser. I'm using Chrome, and so the downloads show up on the bottom toolbar here, but other browsers have a downloads folder that pops up or a save as option. We'll go ahead and look at the file in that folder. And you'll just want to cut or copy it off to a local drive. Put it in there. You see, I already have some examples in here about the naming convention. The naming convention doesn't have to be anything in particular, but you know, this is a suggested naming convention, something with the date of the event, something about location, and then whether the KML file is the points or the path file for that specific event. Okay, then we'll just go ahead and do a polygons export. If I can get it to click here on the map. I've zoomed in a little bit too far here, so I've probably cut off a portion of my polygon here, but just for example purposes, we'll go ahead and export that. All right, and there's the KML link for that one. So we would simply just go ahead and cut and paste over to our local folder with that one as well. And I won't do a ton of these, I just wanted to show you how to make an extraction from the DAT. We'll use some of these examples as we move along here. So after you're done in the DAT, you'll want to go to the Interactive Damage Mapper, and you'll start in this middle section. And basically it's just going to be data entry from here before you run the script. And so for each area of damage, we'll want to enter the data. And we're just going to pick a dummy date in the future here for this particular event. You want to fill out a date, give it your CWA ID, give it a meaningful, it could be a county, it could be a city. I had someone number their tornadoes, it just did tornado 1, 2, 3, like that, that matched the listing below the map. In Kentucky, we like counties, so we'll go with Adair County. Then you'll want to choose the points file for that and the path file for that. Okay. And then you'll have to bear with me here. I'm going to go ahead and fill in some metadata so we can see an example of how this works. So the start time was 12:24. The end time was 12:50. This is in Central Daylight Time. EF rating of 1 with 100 mile an hour winds, 7.68 miles, 200 yards, and no injuries or deaths with this one. So after you get all the data filled out for this first tornado, then you click Add Damage, and it shows up in this table down below here. And so you're going to keep doing this process for all the areas of damage that you want to add to your map. We're just going to do one more here so we can see a good map. We're going to use a city this time called Zeering. Started at 102. And this one was also an EF1, 110 miles an hour wind. Okay, so we've got all of our metadata filled out for the Zeering tornado. So we'll go ahead and we will add this as well. So you just want to double check this list before your final step here and make sure everything looks correct. If you do find a mistake on your list, you can press this red X, which will delete the row, and then you can go back and re-enter that damage. Now, I know that's not the fanciest way. Ideally, each of these elements would be editable. This is our first iteration of the interactive mapper, so we'll work on that for the next version here, so there'll be less data entry. But after everything looks satisfactory, you click the Submit All Damage button. Okay, and then you're going to get this return page, which again is going to look a little goofy, doesn't look quite right. This is where we're going to right-click and do View Page Source to see the source code. Now, there is a little bit of source code here to deal with, but it's literally just copy and paste. You don't do anything to the source code other than copy and paste. We've been doing these interactive maps here for 3 years, and everybody in the office, all skill levels of HTML, can do the copy and paste and have successfully created these maps. So, please don't let this scare you. I'm going to make it as easy as possible. And in the future, hopefully the interactive damage mapper might be able to inject this into your page or make the copy and paste even easier. So basically, there's two portions to copy and paste from your source code page. And the best way to do this is to just have the source code page up right next to your CMS page that you want to copy and paste to. So you'll want to go to the source code portion of the CMS page, storm summary page, that you want to copy and paste these sections into. And you'll want to look for sections. There's two specific sections with a ton of stars. Here's one right here. That should hopefully catch your eye. And this one is the copy and paste for the HTML portion of the map. So whenever you go up here, you'll see the start for the HTML portion. And it says do not include the top line, so you'll start with the second line and just highlight until you hit the end marker. And there's the end marker, so you'll just do a right-click, copy, go back to the CMS, and paste it over the stars. All right, then you'll hit save. Save often in the CMS so you don't lose any work. Oh, and I've been logged out. Okay, bear with me just 1 minute and we'll get logged back in here. that happens occasionally when working in the CMS here, so just practice this troubleshooting. We'll go back to edit our content for editing our page. And we're editing this particular page. Sorry for the delay here. We'll wait for it to come up. And again, this is the particular storm summary page that we're adding this map to. So we'll press source. I don't believe it saved our first edit. It did not, so we'll just go ahead and make that copy and paste one more time. We'll paste right over the stars. And save. Okay, and then the second area is a JavaScript area to copy and paste. So go back to the source code. And the JavaScript area, especially if you have a lot of data on your storm summary page, will be closer to the end. So again, you'll be looking for those lines of stars in your source code. And there they are. This is the JavaScript portion. You'll go to the source code return page. This is start the JavaScript portion. And you'll start with the next line and copy on down so you hit the end marker. And there's the end marker, end code for interactive map. So you'll copy that. And you'll paste it right over the stars again. And we'll go ahead and save. And that's all there is to it. Like I said, I know that sometimes getting into the source code is a little bit scary, but this is literally just copy and paste. You don't have to do any specific editing, changing of anything. It's just literally copy and paste right on in there. And whenever you do finally get your source code saved, you'll notice in the CMS that the map will not show in the CMS preview. That's to be expected. You'll see the other items down below, but the map won't actually show until you're on the internet page, then it will render. So again, here's without the code, and then we'll refresh it and hopefully get a map. All right, and there's our tornadoes that we plotted. So with that, just wanted to throw this slide out there for you. We have a friendly interactive damage map tech support team, which is myself, Joe, and Mike. If you have any with creating these interactive damage maps, please email us, give us a call, chat with us. We're more than willing to help you create one, walk you through any step that you're having trouble with. Again, the maps are not required, but we do hope that everyone will try one. Would love for every office to have at least one that you can have internally and also share with your partners to get feedback from them. So with that said, that's all I have. Are there any questions?
Thanks, Andrea. I do not see any questions yet. If you do have one, go ahead and raise your hand or type it in if you're not included in the audio pin. We have another team member online. Chance, you had mentioned before we started about your use of this and how some people think it might be a little scary, like Andrea stated. Do you want to kind of give a little thought on how it was for you to use it the first time?
You bet. Can everybody hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, sorry. I was going back and forth between microphone and phone. You know, I'm not a person that's really adept to using HTML code whatsoever. So basically what I did is I just used the initial layout that Kevin and Kelly talked about, where you select all the different tabs and how many subsections for those. And I do encourage folks to probably include maybe one extra subsection than what you're anticipating, because more pictures generally come in a little bit later. So it'll just make it a little bit easier for you at that point in time. But I do agree, and it's something that I've heard here at our office, tons of information to try and absorb, and it makes it seem like it's extremely difficult. But I just want folks to realize that once you actually get into the process where you're selecting your tabs, you know, how many tornadoes and the subsections and the teaser images and then all the other different tabs and subsections and which one you want to show first, then writing a quick overview, and that sets your initial template in CMS. And the reason that we went with CMS is because that's just the direction that we're going. We want to be consistent from one office to the next, so that our national partners or even local partners that have to deal with multiple offices know exactly where to go on each office's website to find this type of information. But once that template is created, I mean, it's just as simple as uploading your images into the using the CMS uploader into a file, and then right-clicking and adding the images like Kevin was showing. And it just made it very simple for us. We, you know, we created a short one for the April 26th event, and it took me about 30 minutes to create the summary. Did not have any tornadoes. We just had some wind and hail damage. So it made it very simple. You know, one of the things I might suggest is, I know that Andrea's interactive damage map is very nice, and I think that's a great add-on to this, but if you wanted to get a summary up there very quickly, you could just do that and then enhance it with the interactive damage map just a little bit later. But like I said, it only took me about 30 minutes, and I'm not real sharp with code. And what I liked about it was I was able to go in and create it, and then somebody following me in the evening shift or even on the midnight shift knew exactly what the story was or the summary was titled, and they could go in, they could add images without having to worry about going through all the different code, where to put that information. They could just simply just do a copy and paste, and were able to easily enhance what I had already done. So instead of only, you know, maybe a handful of people per office creating these summaries, I easily foresee anybody in the office being able to work with these summaries. So I think with just a little bit of training locally, I think everybody would be able to take off for this. A couple other things is, I know that these summaries are utilized quite a bit by our local media outlets, especially the newspapers and radio stations. They like to go to the offices' summaries so that they can provide that information to their subscribers and their folks. And also the local EMs utilize this information quite a bit for their after-action reports to kind of get the broad picture from what we have. And then I know another question that was brought up was, okay, we've got this standardized summary. How long until I have to have it online? And basically, I don't think that there is going to be a deadline, and at least at this point in time, to have a summary up there, because you're going to define, in essence, what summaries you place on the web and the ones that you don't. It's completely optional. You know, we do have to put the tornadoes into the DAT kit, but the actual summary itself is completely up to you. I mean, if you have a couple of penny-sized hail reports and one brief touchdown in open country, you may not want to create a summary event for that. Just put the tornado touchdown in the DAT kit and move on. So a lot of this is going to be office decision process only for them to determine what they want to put up there. So I really think it's pretty easy, and I think that our partners are really going to like it as well. So that's kind of what I have, Jim.
All right, great. Thanks, Chance. Yeah, I want to reiterate something that Chance said there at the end is we have a lot of information today, obviously, and there was a lot of options, a lot of tab options. We're not saying that the offices now have to go out and do winter surveys and, you know, wind event surveys and things of that nature. It's just an option available. Like Chance mentioned, if you decide you want to do a summary, this is the avenue that you would use to place it on the web. What we do expect from the offices is if you do have a large tornado, one that produces a significant media interest, something that, you know, the Central Region Rocks working with you on, obviously that storm would have some type of survey or summary, and that would be in there, are available for this format. So come June 1st or sooner if you're ready or you feel you're ready and you do have an event, this format and the archive location that Kelly brought up earlier in the training is what we will do as a region. Andrea, I do not see any questions for your section, so I think we're good there. Just to close out the training this morning, again, thanks everybody for joining us. I am recording this, so I will render this and send it out to all the offices when that's available. And if you have any questions, again, come to any team member. We'll gladly answer those questions. The main tech support are your presenters today, Kelly, Andrea, and Kevin. So with that, again, thanks everybody, and we'll be talking to you soon. Thank you.